SEP Fanfic Readings presents Accidental Proposal by C.J. Redd. Chapter 28. Alive and Charmed. They both turned and looked to the man standing in the doorway. He looked like the man behind the unmistakable voice, but didn't. It was enough to give them both pause as they studied him quickly. "It can't be," Draco said, standing up, letting go of Hermione's hand. "You died. I grieved you. There was a funeral, and—" Hermione stood up as well, finally out of her stupor, and quickly slammed the door shut, throwing up wards to lock the man in. Before Lucius could stand up and protest, she froze and silenced him, then turned her wand on the man who looked nothing like the professor she remembered. For one, this man had meat on his bones, no lanky hair, and was smiling. "Now, Miss Granger, if not for the impressive non-verbal spells and wards that will take me some time to break down, I would have to dock you points for your temper." Draco was still staring at the man in shock, and Hermione quickly froze him as well, her eyes narrowed.
"If you are indeed Professor Snape, what were the last words you said to Harry before we all thought you died?"
She watched the man stiffen before his eyes went as cold as ice.
"I told the Pratt that he had his mother's eyes, which is still true, even if he lacks her wit and personality."
Hermione lowered her wand and sank to the chair, her hand clasping Draco's again.
"It's him," she said softly. "No one would know that but him, besides Harry. Ron didn't even hear it."
Severus Snape was glaring at her.
"How is it you heard me?"
Hermione sighed.
"Harry told me. I was trying to find the stupid beesaw I shoved down your throat the next second."
She watched as the dark man rubbed at his throat, where scarring was clearly visible.
"That, and the potions you shoved into me, ensured I did not die. For that, I owe you a life debt."
Hermione waved him off, feeling sick.
"Keep it. We left. We left you, and obviously we shouldn't have."
Her eyes were haunted as she relived that part of the battle.
"We left you to die."
Severus snorted.
"I dare say you had to. Lucius was on his way in. I am not sure what he would have done had he found the three of you."
Hermione whipped her head around to stare at the still frozen and silenced Lucius, who was glaring at her. With a quick wave of her hand, the spell lifted and Lucius rubbed his throat.
"I brought him here and set up elves on him around the clock before I went back to the battle to look for my son."
Hermione saw Draco flush and watched Snape give a small nod as if he was saying he agreed with the man's priorities. Lucius just looked exhausted as he said, "I wasn't even sure he had survived until we banished ourselves here while appealing the trial. I had sworn the elves to secrecy, and with the ministry in my head, I figured it was safest to know nothing." Hermione couldn't help giving the blonde man a look of shock. Perhaps he wasn't as selfish as she had always figured, given that he had no idea Severus Snape was a double agent. Or if he did, if the man would be pardoned. That had been an incredibly selfless thing to do in the midst of chaos. Draco was shaking now, his anger obvious.
"And you are just now informing me. You didn't think I had the right to know."
It was Severus Snape who answered, not Lucius Malfoy.
"Well, no, we did not. You managed to get yourself engaged by ancient magic after getting pissed with friends. I hardly wish to put my life in your inebriated hands."
Hermione had half a smirk before she glared at Snape.
"Oh, stop it. I am just as guilty as is Theodore for not making sure I knew about the stupid magical engagement spell."
Draco let out a small breath and ran his hand down his face, looking exhausted.
"So you survived." "Obviously," Snape said in a rude drawl, causing Draco to glare at him. "But you are in hiding."
Hermione narrowed her eyes and then said slowly,
"He can't be. Kingsley has this house under monitoring spell since Lucius was released."
Severus grunted and moved to pour himself a drink, shaking his head.
"The day I can't hide from Kingsley Shacklebolt and his useless lackeys is the day I die, Miss Granger."
Hermione did smirk now.
"So Kingsley has no clue."
Lucius sighed and shrugged.
"No. However, Severus did approach the French minister who agreed to help him with the new identity."
Severus snorted.
"A new, old identity. I set up a backup plan in case I needed to flee England decades ago. I have carefully created my current alias, and you will find that as far as France is concerned, I am Sebastian de Cree."
Hermione gasped, sitting up in shock, as Draco cursed under his breath.
"You are Master de Cree?"
Snape nodded, his eyes laughing at them.
"I am. Now the potions apprentice is easy enough to procure for Draco. But your charms mastery apprenticeship is trickier, Miss Granger."
Hermione sighed and sank back, feeling dejected.
"You are a charms master," she said in annoyance. "As Severus Snape, can't you just..."
Severus Snape cut her off with a frown.
"Use your rather well-developed brain, Miss Granger. Claiming a dual mastery would be too suspicious. I was the only potions master who also took out a mastery in charms."
Draco nodded, his face anxious and thoughtful.
"It was rather well known, and if I remember from my youth, it made your potions research highly sought after."
Severus shrugged, looking nonplussed.
"Yes, well, the two masteries work well together. When Dumbledore offered me the opportunity to get the dual mastery, I jumped at it."
Hermione shook her head.
"So what do we do about my mastery?"
Lucius looked at Snape, looking a bit unsure, as Severus poured another glass of whatever spirit he was drinking.
"Drink that first. Hand me your wand, and we will discuss your options."
Hermione glared at him, and she accepted the drink.
"I am not giving you my wand," she said firmly.
Severus Snape chuckled.
"I don't trust your temper, Miss Granger. Unlike your dim-witted fiancé, I know what kind of damage you can do when you get the news you don't approve of. So, if you want our help, give your wand to Draco."
Hermione chewed on her lip as she drank the excellent brandy, and then, sighing in annoyance, handed her wand over to Draco. Severus nodded, but looked weary, and pulled out his own wand, erecting some kind of ward in the middle of the room, which would protect himself and Lucius Malfoy. Hermione narrowed her eyes, watching the ward carefully. She could tear it down, but not without her wand, the bastard. Once Snape was satisfied with the wall of protection, he nodded at Lucius.
"You tell her. I wish to enjoy the show. I would put up a shield, Draco."
Draco looked at his godfather as if he had lost his mind, but scooted over on the couch, placing Hermione down next to him, and did, in fact, put up a shield to protect him from her wandless magic. Hermione rolled her eyes.
"Oh, for the love of Merlin! What is it you two have planned that will anger me so?"
Lucius cleared his throat, and said in a deceptively calm voice, "I have a mastery in charms, Miss Knott."
Hermione stood up, her hair crackling with her anger, and not even noticing Draco flinch.
"No! Absolutely not! Study under you, you hate me! I am not even sure you have processed that I am not even a Muggle-born anymore!"
Severus gave a soft, lazy chuckle in a sarcastic drawl, said, "You were raised with them. You can hardly blame him for thinking you are not a pure-blood witch."
Hermione turned her angry glare on him.
"I was raised by Muggles, and I am proud of it! There were wonderful parents who supported me with all of their hearts! They never cared I was a witch. They just loved me."
Draco pulled her hand and pulled her down into his lap again, wincing as he did, but he rubbed her arms, trying to calm her.
"Hermione, father is brilliant at charms."
Hermione huffed and continued to glare between the two wizards.
"This is the only option. Do you realize how odd it will seem to the wizarding world that I am apprenticing under a man who should still be in prison? We have to keep it a secret he is here, remember?"
Lucius sighed and rubbed the back of his neck, his eyes not leaving his son's.
"Like Severus, I had an exit plan in place decades ago. I, too, have a secret identity that I can use here in France."
Draco sat up, his face showing his shock and anger.
"You had an out and didn't take it!"
Lucius grimaced.
"The bastard took my wand, was living in the manor, and I was in prison within months of him returning. I had no time to enact my escape plans, Draco."
Snape made a rude noise and said quietly,
"And your Aunt Bella could track you and your mother with her blood. Once she was released, it tied your father's hands, Draco."
Hermione looked at them in horror as what they were saying penetrated her skull.
"Why would Lucius, blood supremacist Malfoy, have a Death Eater escape plan?"
Draco looked at her, his face showing his surprise, and then turned to his father.
"That is a good question, father." Lucius looked a bit sick. I wasn't a double agent like Severus, but I could see that our master was unstable. His attack on Harry Potter, how inconsistent he became. Obviously, Severus has filled me in on his horcruxes, which fit the puzzle together well. I had a small child and a wife terrified of what I was involved in. I barely escaped prison after his first downfall. Shortly after he returned, I approached Severus, making sure we kept it brief, let him know I was on his side. Hermione gasped.
You knew he was sided with the light?
Lucius glared at her, and then nodded curtly. As soon as Lily was threatened. Severus cleared his throat. However, he never spoke of it. Not until after the incident in the graveyard. Dumbledore, however, was not interested in any other spies in his ranks. Especially one such as Lucius that he despised.
Hermione nodded, grabbing Draco's cold hand. So you gave information to Professor Snape?
Lucius shrugged. I did what I could to keep him alive. Don't paint me as the hero. My main priority was and always will be my family. But I knew that I needed Severus to succeed in whatever plan he was wrapped up in.
Hermione shook her head, looking at Draco, who was pale and fixated on his father.
Why did you let me join? You inflamed this hatred in me. Why?
Lucius Malfoy looked uncomfortable and stood up, pacing over to the sidebar to pour himself a drink and downing it quickly.
I did not let you join. You did that yourself as a way to protect your mother.
Severus Snape grunted, joining the conversation.
And it did save your mother, so stop berating yourself over it.
Lucius sighed.
As for the rest, well, I fell out of favor, had my wand stripped. I did the best I could and made sure you believed all that hateful propaganda was part of keeping you alive. We had roles to play, all of us.
Hermione was shaking with anger and shock.
He was a child! He shouldn't have been used in your chess game!
Severus Snape slammed down his glass, his face a sight to behold.
As was Potter, and Dumbledore sent him off to be slaughtered. The same with you and Mr. Weasley.
Hermione was breathing hard, but she had to close her eyes as she thought of all the anger she still held for Dumbledore and his riddles and mysteries and sending children off to starve on a horcrux hunt. Draco rubbed her arm and then said quietly,
So you will use your allies to teach Hermione charms, and we can stay in France together.
Lucius nodded curtly.
The French ministry has agreed to this arrangement, and will sign off on your masteries.
Hermione could feel Draco relax, and suddenly wanted to hex him.
But I study under Lucius Malfoy for 2 years. Has it not occurred to anyone that we will in all likelihood kill one another in the first week?
Severus chuckled, holding up his glass to her.
So switch with your fiancé. You can do potions, and he can do charms.
Hermione crossed her arms angrily.
I wanted to do both, but Draco just wants to do potions.
Severus raised an eyebrow and considered her.
Let us sweeten the deal, then, Miss Granger. A Slytherin tactic, if you will.
Hermione made a rude noise, but waved at him to continue, while Draco sat up behind her excitement rolling off of him in waves.
What could sweeten this deal that I would care about enough to put up with Lucius sorting Malfoy?
Lucius didn't look insulted, but rather smirked before he ducked his head, and she could feel Draco chuckling behind her.
Severus Snape regarded her for a moment and then said, I will agree to also take you on as an apprentice, and you can study for both the masteries you wish at the same time.
Draco whistled as Hermione went utterly still.
2 masteries at once. Can you do that?
She asked in awe. It had honestly never occurred to her.
Severus shrugged. Most people could not. You, however, are swotty enough it shouldn't be a problem.
Hermione stared for a moment at the wall, not looking at any of the wizards before she waved her hand in irritation.
I want time to discuss this with Draco.
This seemed to surprise both of the older wizards because they nodded, and Hermione turned to a fiancé, holding out her hand for her wand, which she gave her without a fight, and watched as she quickly threw up a silencing spell with her own wards, which would hide them from their audience.
Draco, what do you think of all this?
Draco smirked.
That I am glad my godfather is alive, and I can study under him. He is a brilliant potions master.
Hermione nodded, biting her lip.
And me working with your father on charms.
Draco sighed. You can always feed him to a dragon, and just get a mastery in potions for now. Hermione laughed and hugged him, resting her head on his chest, listening to his heart.
Your father is brilliant at charms, even if he is a total git.
Draco nodded, rubbing her back. He was a horrible father, but a damn good wizard. You would be hard-pressed to find a better master, and we have been looking. My father could run circles around that American bloke.
Hermione rolled her eyes. But it's your father.
Draco shrugged. The only con in the scenario. We get out of England, continue our education, and you get that double mastery I know you have been dreaming about. Are you saying you can't handle my father?
Hermione bristled before she deflated and hit him playfully. Stop it. That was underhanded. Of course I can handle your father. It's just a question of if I bloody wish to.
Draco laughed and kissed her. He is terrified of you. I think you will be fine, love.
Hermione nibbled at his lip and then leaned back. You want to do this, don't you?
Draco nodded, his eyes hooded but shining. We save 2 years if you wish to finish the two masteries at once.
Hermione closed her eyes and slumped in defeat. Fine, but if I do murder your father, you can't hate me.
Draco kissed her nose playfully. I could never hate you. Now, shall we tell them and get back to school? You have all those revisions to do.
His tone was teasing. Hermione gave him a small smile and then nodded. Fine, but I have conditions and I want them to take a wizard oath.
Draco chuckled, shaking his head at her audacity. You can try, love.
Hermione narrowed her eyes and turned, destroying the ward Severus had set up, and got a thrill at his look of shock that his wards fell so quickly.
Have you decided? Lucius asked with a small smile. I think wards shouldn't be a problem.
Hermione gave him a small smirk and tilted her head.
We accept. However, we have conditions.
Snape sighed, pouring himself another drink. You mean you have conditions?
Draco laughed and Hermione pinched him.
No, I mean we do. Like it or not, Professor, Draco is my fiancé and we make decisions together.
Lucius snorted, folding his arms. If you are anything like Sissy, you mean you decide and I follow along.
Draco had to cough to hide his laugh, nodding at his father discreetly as Hermione bristled in indignation.
Severus Snape cut in before a battle could ensue. Your conditions.
Hermione let out a breath of relief. He was willing to listen, and that was more than she had anticipated.
Right, my conditions.
4 hours later saw them back in Hogwarts with their friends surrounding them all in various degrees of shock. Ginny shook her head, her eyes wide.
No wonder you made us take an all an oath before you told us the solution Lord Malfoy had found. I can't believe you agreed to study under him.
Pansy nodded, sitting on Theo's lap, who was staring at his best mate, stunned, speechless.
I can't believe it myself, but your father is brilliant at charms, and we all know how brilliant Master Decree is. I bet you couldn't find anyone better than Snape for potions.
Blaise shook his head. Only you would go for a double mastery at the same time, Hermione.
Harry chuckled at this and nodded.
That does seem a bit nutty.
Hermione blew out an annoyed breath.
Yes, well, I will be fine.
Tracy snorted in laughter.
Of course you will. You are our wonderful little organized SWAT.
Daphne chuckled as Pansy grinned and Ginny tried to hide her chuckle. Hermione rolled her eyes and crossed her arms.
Oh, shut up.
The tension was broken and everyone started laughing. Draco, she could feel, was immensely relieved and she shuddered as his hands made circles on her thighs.
We don't have the dorm to ourselves, she whispered at him as she discreetly kissed his neck.
He grunted. Trust me.
Hermione sighed and allowed him to pull her up, leaving behind the chattering in this common room, to find more in another as he led her out of the portrait door. When he stopped in front of Snape's old quarters, she raised an eyebrow at his grin.
My godfather might have given me the password and mentioned there was a spare bedroom. Technically, we are still in Slytherin space, so we are not breaking any school rules.
Hermione went wide-eyed and then laughed.
You want to make love in Snape's old flat?
Draco shrugged, waving his wand to drop the wards, with the counter curse his godfather had given him.
Not in his bed, for Merlin's sake. Just in the flat.
Hermione shook her head and allowed him to lead her through the portrait hole.
This is such a bad idea.
Draco grinned at her, sweeping her into his arms. "But you like it. Admit it." Hermione shivered and tilted her neck so that he could leave a trail of kisses on her pulse point.
"Maybe,"
she said on a small gasp as his hands gripped her behind.
"Draco, find the spare room."
A chuckle met this remark, and he swept her up, carrying her through the study and down a hallway, before he kicked through a door that led to a small room that had just a bed in it, a bed with green drapes and bedding.
"So Slytherin,"
Hermione said, nibbling at his jaw and pulling at his jumper. He snorted and yanked his jumper off, starting to work on hers.
"It's Snape, of course. The bed is green."
Hermione giggled and kicked off her shoes.
"I can't believe we're doing this."
"Hermione." She opened her eyes wearily and allowed him to take one of her hands, carefully intertwining their fingers.
"What?"
"Thank you. What you were doing. Putting up with my father. Thank you."
Hermione lifted her head and met his gaze, which was so full of love.
"Don't thank me. Just keep loving me when I rant about wanting to hex the prattish man."
He laughed loudly and pulled her head back down, kissing the top of it and tucking them under the covers with magic, cuddling her to him under the soft sheets.
"I will keep you from hexing him if you keep me from doing it."
Hermione kissed his chest and giggled.
"I won't live in that house with them, no matter how big it is."
Draco rubbed her back, his tone teasing.
"So demanding."
Draco groaned.
"Draco!"
"We will find a suitable place for us in France. Maybe the Paris townhouse,
Hermione sighed happily, allowing peace and serenity to seep into her bones, as she listened to her lover's heart calm with hers.
"Perfect,"
she said sleepily. They both fell asleep with smiles on their faces, looking forward to graduation for the first time.